Hello Earthlings, welcome to CPEDIC. In this video, we are going to look at the problem E and F from the recent Code Forces D3 round 677. So let's start, shall we? The problem E is called Two Round Dances. One day N people, where N is E and even number, met on a plaza and made two round dances. Each round dance consists of exactly N by two people. Our task is to find the number of ways N people can make two round dances if each round dance consists of exactly N by two people. And dance circle consisting of one or more people, two round dances are indistinguishable or equal, you can say, if one can be transformed into another by choosing the first participant, or you can simply rotate one arrangement to get the second one. Then they are not, if we get the second one by just rotating the first one, then they are same. For example, for n is equal to 4, we can have these three arrangements. In first group, we can have these 1, 2, 2, 4 and 4, 1. And the second group, we can have 3, 4, 3, 1 and 3, 2 correspondingly. We need to, and n is pretty less, as you can see. Now let's see how we can solve this problem. So we have been given that n is an even number. And one thing which we need to notice here is, suppose we are having two rounds R1, and let's call them R1 and R2. And if in the first round we are having, for n is equal to 2, we are having an arrangement 1, 2. And if in the second round we are having an arrangement 2, 1, we need to notice that these both are equal. These are not different from each other, because we only see how we are distributing people into groups, or into groups such that those groups can participate in a particular round. So these two are same. Now, and yeah, again, 1, 3, 2 is equal to 3, 2, 1, because we can simply rotate it by 1, we can say, or rotate it by 2, if I'm not wrong, you can rotate it by 2 places, then it will result in this arrangement. So rotation is also a key factor. Now let's focus for n is equal to 8. As in one group only n by 2 people can be there in a particular round, so in one round we need to select 4 people in round 1 and the other 4 people will be on round 2. And I have mentioned that this 1, 2 is equal to 2, 1. So we just need to find out the 4 people we should be having in round 1. That can be found out simply by choosing 8C4, or in other words, n choose n by 2. In this way, we can choose n by 2 people from a group of n peoples, and not peoples, n people. Yeah, and so we have selected the people for the first round. We do not need to select the people for the second round, because the people which we have not chosen will be automatically selected for the second round. This is for the selection. Now you see, we are having 4 persons in round 1 and 4 persons in round 2. The way we can arrange these 4 persons in a circular arrangement, because it has been mentioned that they are dancing in a circular manner. If we are having n elements in a circle, then the number of arrangements we can have, different arrangements or permutations you can say, is equal to n minus 1 factorial. It's a simple formula. So we would be having 4 persons in round 1. To arrange them into different arrangements, we need 4 minus 1 factorial. And for each of these, these arrangement, like we'll be picking each of these 3 factorial arrangements, for each of those we can have 4 minus 1 factorials arrangements of round 2, because we can also arrange the second group as well. For example, this here in round one we are having the same set of people which are ABC and ABC, but in round two we can have we can have XYZ and we can also have XZY. So for the same arrangement of our round one, we can just change the arrangement of people in the round two, so that in that way it will increase or increment the number of arrangements we can distribute people in rounds. So what I was saying is, for all of these 3 factorial people from round 1, we would be having 3 factorial, which is equal to 4 if we are having n people in a circle. We will be having n minus 1 factorial arrangements. And here if you see, in this case n is actually equal to n by 2, because in a particular round we can have n by 2 people. So let's reiterate that again. I have these two rounds. First, what we would be doing is, we would be choosing and choose n by 2. So we have chosen n by 2 people for round 1. After that, for all, we need to arrange these n by 2 persons, and for that we need n by 2 minus 1 factorial. And for each of these arrangements we can have n by 2 minus 1 factorials arrangements of round 2. And the last thing which I want to focus on is, which I mentioned it in the beginning, this round 1 2 is equal to 2 1. So suppose I'm considering a group of 1, 2, 3, 4. I have chosen 2 persons for my round 1. Let's say I have picked 1 and 3. So, then round 2 would be consisting of 2 and 4. But also, as I have done n choose n by 2, there must also be a case where I'm choosing 2, 4 in the first group itself. And in that case, the second group would be containing 1, 3. But these two arrangements are same. So for a particular arrangement, we are counting it twice till this point in our formula. So we need to divide it by 2, because these two are same as far as this problem statement is concerned. So after doing all this, we would be dividing our answer by 2, so that all such cases are counted only once. So let's just write down the final formula. Answer is, first of all, our answer would be n choose n by 2. Then what we do is, answer is equal to n by 2 minus 1 factorial into n by 2 minus 1 factorial. These are the arrangements of round 1. These are for round 2, and we need to divide it by 2 as well, so that only we are counting all such arrangements only once. And we need to multiply this with our previous combination as well, and choose n by 2. So this is the final formula we would be having. This is equal, which is equal to the answer. Let's see the code now. Yes, first of all, I've found out the value of my factorials from 1 to 20. Then I'm simply finding out this. This is equal to n choose 2, n choose n by 2. This is the shift operation, which is equal to n by 2. I'm shifting the elements by 1. So you can just write down as nc n by 2. And then I'm multiplying my answer with factorial of n by 2 minus 1. Again, factorial of n by 2 minus 1. And dividing it by 2 as well, because I only want to count that arrangement only once. And at the end, I'm printing out the answer. Why the first two statements are consisting nc by n minus 2? Because there is a formula. Suppose we are having 8c4. It can be found out by 8 into 7 into 6 into 5 divided by 4 factorial. So what I've done is, to calculate this, I found out the factorial of factorial of 8. And I've divided it by factorial 4, again factorial of 4. Actually, this is the formula itself of nc choose. So that's all for this problem. Let's look at the last problem, which is problem F, it is called zero remainder sum. We have been given a matrix A of size n cross m, which is consisting integer values, and for a particular row, in a particular row we can choose at most m by 2 elements. We need to apply the floor function to it. We can choose at most m by 2 elements on a particular row. Our task is to choose elements using by this constraint. We can choose the elements in from the whole matrix and by satisfying this constraint, and after choosing all those, our sum should be divisible by this number k. We need to find out the maximum such sum we can find. In other words, we can choose no more than half of elements in each row. Yep. So yes, we can even choose zero elements from a row, as zero is divisible by k. And if we see, the values of n, k, n, m and k are pretty less. So using this looking at this constraint, I figured it out that we can use dynamic programming to solve this problem. So let's see how we can solve this. So we see that value of n, m and k are less than equal to 70. So let's see, when I'm talking about a matrix of size n, m and I'm talking about a particular row, let's say this row. Now what are the things I should be focusing on, or what really matters when I'm calculating my answer? The first thing which matters is the row on which I am currently at. The second thing is the column which I am currently at, or in other words, these two, when we combine these two values, it basically tells us at which cell we are at. Then we can find out how many more elements we can choose from this particular row. So this can be termed as remaining elements, or let's call them left. Let's see how I used left. Yeah, I used the left after this. So the third thing which I should be able to find out is mod. Like if I start adding elements from this particular cell, let's say I'm talking about this cell. Now I can add elements from this range. The elements which I can use, if I'm going from left to right and top to bottom, then if I'm at this cell, then I can consider these elements after my operation. I do not need to consider the elements which are above this particular cell. These elements I have already considered them. So the third thing which I want to focus on is the mod. Mod is basically the sum which I would be getting from this particular cell, and I've taken the modulus of k, this value. So let's call it mod. And the last thing is equal to left. That is the number of elements we can choose from this particular row. How many more elements we can choose, because there is a constraint on the number of elements we can choose a particular row. So if you see, the range of this is 70. The range of this is 70, and the value of mod will be lesser than 70 always. So even the range of this is 70. And for a particular row, we can choose at most n by 2 elements. So the range of this is 35 at most. If the value of column, if the value of m is equal to 70, then we can choose at most 35 elements. And this is within the range of the time constraint and the space constraint. So I will be building my solution based on this. Initially, I will be calling my function, a recursive solve function, on the element which is present at the first row and which it is at the leftmost position, the top left element, which is at the column coordinate 0, 0, and I need to find out elements whose sum is equal to, let's say, sum is the mod. If I take the mod k of that particular sum, it should be equal to 0 if I'm talking about the cell 0, 0. So initially, when I've called my function, let's call that solve, I would be calling on the index 0, 0, and I need to find out the sum whose mod is equal to 0, and the remaining number of elements I can choose from that particular row. as I'm at the first element of my row at this point, I can choose most m by 2 elements. So initially my call to the my recursive function would be this. Now let's see what can be the cases when I'm talking about my solution, where these are the indexes, this is the mode, and this is the remaining number of elements I can choose from my function or from my row actually. If I see the value of I is equal to n minus 1, that is I am on the last row, and either I'm left with 0 elements, that is I cannot choose any more elements from this row, or I see that I have reached to the end of my matrix, that is j is equal to m if I'm considering 0 based indexing. At this point it means I've considered all the elements I can in my matrix, so I need to figure out that is sum which I've calculated till this point, is that divisible by k or not. So I check whether this value of mod is equal to 0 or not. If it is equal to 0, I simply return 0. Otherwise, I return a value which will nullify all the answers I have calculated till this point in my recursive call. So I'll return a negative value of 10 to the power 8. Because even if we sum up all the elements, the value of AI is 70, and at most I can have 70 into 70 elements. It would always be lesser than this 10 to the power 8. So initially I would be putting my variable answer, I would be putting a value 0. And when I calculate answer on a new recursive call, I would be taking a max of it, like max of answer or my recursive function. So if you return a negative minus 10 to the power 8 value, it means I cannot find a solution if I have reached to this state, because I have considered all the elements in my matrix and still I am not able to find out that particular combination whose sum is divisible by k. So I need to just nullify this particular recursive function. To do that, I can at the end I return a such one value which will nullify all the sums which I have taken till this point. So I return a minus value. And let's see, otherwise if we are not in the last row and we see either j is equal to m, it means that we have considered the whole row, or we see that we are left with 0 elements, we cannot choose any more elements in our row. So then we move to the next row. So we call the solve function or I plus 1 j, and mode remains to be the same, and left as we are calling on a new row, so we would be considering it from the first column, from the column 0, and from there we can choose m by 2 elements. So new call would start from m by 2. And in all, if I see I've calculated, if my dp, I've calculated my answer to this particular state in my dp array, I return that dp value. Otherwise I need to check these three conditions. I'll be, let's say in m I'm storing array of I j mod of k. So it basically tells me the mode I would be getting from this particular element if I add it to my list of elements. Now there are three cases. I want to find out the sum of elements whose mode is equal to this. If I mode, by mode I mean the sum of all the elements which I choose from here on, if I take the mode of it, mode of k, it should be equal to mod. That is what I want from my this particular call. But if I see this from this particular current element, I'm getting the mod value as m. There can be three cases. M can be greater than mod, and m can be lesser than mod, or m can be equal to mod. So in these three cases, I'm considering the current element. If m is greater than mod, in this case, suppose the value of k is 5. And from this particular element, I want to find out the sum, I want to collect or find out the elements whose sum, if I take the sum of all the elements and then take the mod, it should be equal to 2. But if I see that this m is equal to 3 and I am adding this element, so at the end, if adding all, after adding all that, after considering this element, then I need to find out the elements whose sum is equal to, suppose I am getting the sum from my remaining recursive call, then the mod of this should be equal to k minus m minus mod. You can figure out this term, you can just take few examples. And in this case, when m is lesser than mod, suppose I wanted a value 2 and k is equal to 5, but I only got 1 in this m. So in my new recursive call, I can simply call it by mod minus m. So I then, after this, considering this current element array of ij, I just need to find out elements whose mod is equal to mod minus m. And in this third case, when m is equal to mod, it means after adding the current elements, the sum which I have taken till this point, it becomes equal to, which is, it is equal to divisible by k. So in my next recursive call, I would be calling the new function as mod is equal to 0, because I found out the mod which I required. Now I need to collect or figure out few more elements. If I take the sum of those elements, the mod of those elements should be equal to 0. These are the three cases if I am considering the current elements. Like I am considering the current element, I am adding this a array of ij. In the next case, when I am not considering the current element, I simply call my recursive function on the next element of my matrix and mod will remain the same. I will not be changing the mod, remaining elements will remain the same. And in all these three upper cases, I will change the mod as I have mentioned, and I am also decrementing this left variable by 1 because I am using the current element. I am using this array of ij. That's all for this problem. Let's see the code. It is, if you know about dynamic programming, it is a pretty easy one. So yes, I have initialized all these. This is my array, a matrix, and this is my dp array. I have explained the states of my dp. I am initializing my dp to minus 1. I've called my array on 000 m by 2 as I have explained. These are the indexes. This is the mod I require from this cell onwards. These are the remaining elements I can choose from this particular row. I see if I am on the last row and I cannot choose any more elements, or I have reached to the end of my matrix. I simply check if mod is equal to 0 or not. If it is not equal to 0, I return min, and I initialize min to minus of 10 to the power 8. And in other cases, if I see this is not the last row and I have reached to the end of my row, or I cannot choose any more elements from my row, I call the recursive function on the next row. So I simply put I plus 1, mod remains to the same as this is the first element, so remaining elements or left will be m by 2 in that case. If I have already calculated my value of dp array, I will simply return it. Otherwise, I am considering all these three cases which I had explained, and this is for the case when I am not considering the current element. And I'm taking the maximum out of all these values, whichever call my function is making, and then I'm returning the dp value. That's all for this problem. I hope you liked it and learned something from it. If you did, please hit the like button, share it with your friends, and consider subscribing to our channel. I'll see you next time. Probably I'll upsolve problem G from this context, which I was not able to solve during the context, but I kind of liked it when I read the problem statement. So till then, take care, sayonara.